for an hour. And actually, we've never done this program live either, so we've got a twofer tonight, and we've never had two guests on here with two different books. The numbers are on the screen. It's Eastern and Central Time Zone is 202-624-1111, and for Mountain and Pacific Time Zones, it's 202-624-1115. You can begin dialing now, and we'll take your calls for our two guests who are going to be here with us for another hour. What is your biggest surprise of what you've heard this week listening to the media about the event of last Tuesday?
Biggest surprise and
are we getting the accurate amount of information, or do you hear a lot of people saying things that you would like to correct on television or read in the newspaper about the intelligence part of this whole process?
Well, there really hasn't been that much that's been said about the intelligence process. It's been, you know, sort of generic complaints about how do we miss this. So I haven't really seen too much in terms of miscommunications about intelligence. There really hasn't been much in terms of writing on specific intelligence operations. I think overall they've got it right in that there's a problem of not being able to infiltrate people into these organizations. And but I haven't really seen too much in terms of bad information.
Let's take our first call from Oakton, Virginia. Go ahead, please. You're on Book Notes.
Hi. You mentioned before that INS might come in for some blame in this. I was an INS agent for quite a number of years. I'm no longer with the agency. But one thing I would point out is that INS's interior enforcement efforts have been greatly restricted over a number of years. And most of its efforts are directed at the southern border. And that's usually by national policy rather than INS's choice. The other thing I'd point out is that a lot of the visa problems don't originate with INS. They originate with the State Department. The State Department's very generous in issuing visas. I wouldn't be surprised if a number of these individuals were here legally under INS law. Maybe they could comment on what the prospect is for increasing INS's interior enforcement rather than restricting it, and restricting some of State Department's sort of generous impulses in handing out visas. I think INS gets a lot of blame unfairly in these cases. They're just a convenient scapegoat.
Okay, thanks.
Well, I think everything's going to be on the table, and the points you raise are very good ones. And it, you know, when all the facts are known about this, that's exactly what might happen.
Let's go next to Albuquerque, New Mexico. Go ahead, please. Albuquerque, you're on the air.
Thank you.
Go ahead, please.
Thank you. Brian?
Yes.
Thank you so much for C-SPAN. It's most wonderful coverage of this terrible incident, if you can put wonderful and terrible in the same sentence. My question is about, has twofold. First of all, the competition among the services and how they all are trying for the funds that are available. Secondly, President Bush has been reinvestigating Star Wars, and my feeling is, listening to these gentlemen, that perhaps we should be investing more in this area rather than Star Wars.
Thanks. Competition a problem among the services?
Oh, it's always a problem, but they've got it fairly well laid out where the different agencies do very different tasks, and I think the competition problem has been alleviated to a large degree. On the second aspect, I think the caller is 100% right. The administration and also a lot of people in the Defense Department have been focusing solely on weapons of mass destruction, which is missiles being fired from North Korea or some other place, and then focusing on the Star Wars project. In other words, thinking too high tech and long term, and while the terrorists have been sort of sneaking under the door.
Washington, D.C., go ahead, please. You're on the air.
Yes. I'm curious, not so much about competition, but lack of coordination and sharing of information among the intelligence agencies, and whether that had an impact on what we saw last week. Secondly, are there implications for biological warfare, given that it looks like we're going to war? Thank you.
Well, I think you may always find some breakdown between, say, the CIA and FBI. There's certainly been the case with regard to counterintelligence in the past. There is, within the CIA, a counterintelligence center which brings together people from the CIA and the FBI and several other agencies which attempts to get around this problem. It may be that even more coordination is needed. There's an organization that operates out of NSA which brings together a lot of intelligence on missiles and space activities that receive SIGINT and everything else and also provides warning. And maybe there's a need to expand the counterintelligence center to make sure that everything is flowing in, a counterterrorism center to make sure everything is flowing in to this to one entity that's related to that subject.
Who watches the biological warfare?
Well, all the agencies have a role in that. That's one of these new things in the 21st century that they're trying to get a handle on. It's much more difficult when you're talking about taking in a couple of flasks of germs or chemicals than watching warheads come in or high explosives. So it's an extremely difficult problem, and that's what I think that's one of the key things that are going to be on the horizon now, since bin Laden has tried different approaches, supposing that he's been involved in all these previous incidents. It's always been something different, blowing up a ship, blowing up an embassy in a foreign country, blowing up a World Trade Center, and you know, everybody's worried that the next step or the step after that may be either biological or chemical.
Moreno Valley, California, go ahead, please.
Yes, first of all, I'd like to say it's a great honor to be able to speak before these highly intelligent gentlemen. I'm a sovereign citizen here in California, representing United States of the America. And my question is, how are your feelings on the application of the science technology to all aspects in regards to truth in the language?
I don't really understand the question.
Let's go next to Richland, Washington. You're on the air. Go ahead, please. Hello, Richland.
I have a question for Jeffrey Richelson. In terms of the U.S. Technical assets, the intelligence community has been undergoing a decline in both funding and the so-called graying of the all-source analysts. What do you propose to be the solution for increasing technical information, increasing complexity of information, and decreasing numbers of analysts, numbers of amount of funding for them, and the dealing with much more information about much more complicated and in a sense multiple lines of evidence leading to something like the terrorist attacks for an organization like the CIA, which has a history, sort of a historic approach to intelligence analysis, now we'll have to come up with a whole new paradigm.
Well, in terms of the technical assets, actually the U.S. has been deploying a fair number of them over the 1990s, starting from really about 1994. We've been launching signals intelligence satellites and photographic reconnaissance imagery satellites at a fairly impressive rate, and these have been updated satellites, so and which partially results in the problem Jim talked about of there being so much data coming down and not enough people to analyze it. In terms of dealing with the complexity of data, that's an area where information technology comes in, where attempts to take all this complex data and look for patterns through a variety of machine-assisted, computer-assisted programs can be very important. Something as simple as the ability to take cables coming in from overseas and sort through them by a machine so that you can find the interesting stuff in 3 minutes rather than having a human analyst take 3 or 4 hours to do it, which is one of the innovations in information technology that have been introduced. The question will still remain, of course, whether there's information there to be found that's relevant to the problem.
Bristol, Connecticut. Good evening. Go ahead, please.
Yes, good evening. I really enjoy your programming, Mr. Lamb.
Thank you.
My question was for Jeff Richelson, and it regards this author, Joseph J. Trento, who's written his third book on the CIA, titled The Secret History of the CIA, supposed to be published next month, and he called Tuesday's attack a massive failure of intelligence. He points out that back in 95, that U.S. officials have known of this possibility because they had this mastermind of the World Trade Center bombing, a Ramzi Shmed Youssef, who was involved in that 93 incident. He was talking about hijacking commercial jetliners and crashing them into major U.S. buildings. Apparently, four suspects in some planned assassination of Pope John Paul II were arrested in the Philippines. And this Youssef lieutenant had this commercial pilot's license from a North Carolina flight school. So it's maintained that this should have given our intelligence people a little hint that maybe this type of approach would be used to do some damage to U.S. sites.
Reaction? Well, if his reporting is accurate, that would certainly seem to be the case. But even beyond what they might have learned from Youssef, I mean, if people had read or seen works of fiction and movies, and the idea is not anything that is really out of the blue. I mean, Tom Clancy in Dead of Honor had a Japanese pilot crashing a 747 into the Capitol. One movie had a plane being hijacked to drop biological warfare agents on Washington. So none of this seems anything that somebody shouldn't have thought of. The question is, now, at some point, do you have enough evidence to think that they're really doing it rather than it simply being a possibility? And that's really one of the things that an investigation has to get at. Was there any information that should have really led to this? And again, if Trento's reporting is accurate, then there would seem to be more than we knew about.
How many, you say the NSA cannot listen to conversations inside the United States?
Well, most of the conversations it listens to are overseas, but there's a small category, including terrorism and counterintelligence, that it can eavesdrop on in the United States if it gets a special warrant.
Can it listen using satellites in foreign countries?
Oh, sure, yeah. That's how it does a lot of its eavesdropping, is with satellites. Satellites picking up communications going out into space, like microwave communications and other kind of communications.
So can it listen to most telephone conversations around the world?
Well, if there's a telephone conversation they want to listen to, they could probably do it one way or another, through one method or another, such as a satellite. That's not to say they can listen to all communications at all times at the same time, but they certainly have the capability to target certain communications.
Can other countries listen to our conversations?
Sure, they do. The Russians have probably one of the largest listening posts in the world, just 90 miles off of Florida in Cuba. It's been there since the early 60s in a place called Lourdes, Cuba, and it eavesdrops on tremendous amount of satellite and microwave communications within the United States.
Still to this day?
Well, there was a report just in the last few weeks or last few months saying that there's a possibility that the Russians may pull it out because they couldn't reach an agreement on a new contract with the with Castro.
Great Valley, New York, you're next. Go ahead, please.
Yes, this is Alice Razek in Great Valley. I just would like to comment on all the theories that are going on. I understand that a lot of these things and what they must do, but the thing that is, that has bothered me and that I thought for quite some time, that they really should close all of our borders. These people that were in here, according to the reports that we've had, studied here, lived here, acted like they were part of the United the American society, and this is what they were here for. And you cannot. You can talk about all the things and all the ballistics and all the methods of trying to avoid these things, but if you don't know who's in your borders and you haven't got any more control than we have of our borders, you're never going to be able to do it. And this is not a surprise to me, because I came from Long Island, and I have thought if they ever blow up the bridges down there, that's all they got to do to create a whole lot of problems.
Thanks. It's a little bit off the subject of intelligence, which you two gentlemen are experts on. What do you think is going on inside of all these intelligence groups that we talked about earlier in the program today?
Well, I think one thing they're doing is reviewing everything they already have, to find that might be relevant to provide evidence of bin Laden's involvement, to identify anybody else involved in these activities, to possibly warn of any future attacks. So I think you just have a lot of people going through everything that they already have, plus changing a lot of the targeting so that whereas we might have photographed a terrorist camp in Afghanistan once a day, now every time a satellite goes over, it's producing an image, shifting a lot of the intercept targeting to Afghanistan, to Pakistan, to other areas that we're going to be very involved with.
What can they? How close on the ground can they see something from a satellite?
Well, resolution is somewhat under 6 inches, meaning that you could see two objects 6 inches apart, or to take the sort of example of a license plate, people have always said you could read a license plate from a satellite. Well, you can't read it, but if you took the license plate off the ground and you put it on the road and say it was a white license plate with a back black road, you'd see that there was an object, a license plate type object there. So you can see an awful lot. You can see not only say that there's a tank there, but what type of tank. Not only that there's an aircraft there, but what type of aircraft.
San Jose, California. Go ahead, please. You're on the air.
Hi, thank you. I was wondering, who would I contact as a taxpayer? I'd like to have access to some of the information that has been gathered on the global imaging system in regards to nuclear testing or contaminated nuclear areas. Radioactive contaminated areas.
Thanks.
Well, that's a little out of my area. I don't know.
How much of what is gathered by the NSA is ever published for the average person to read?
Almost nothing. They have their own little website where they have some information on there about the agency and so forth. But the only way to get information out of NSA is to submit a Freedom of Information Act and request As Jeff and many other people who have done this know, it's very difficult to get any information out of NSA. I mean, I've had to work very hard to get the information I needed for my book. It's something that's very difficult, and I'd like to see it made a little bit easier, but it's to answer your question, it's extremely difficult.
Because people tune into these things later, the National Security Agency is located where?
It's on Fort George G. Meade, which is an Army base halfway between Washington and Baltimore.
So it's about, 30 miles from here?
That's right, about 30 miles.
Employs how many people?
Oh, about 38,000, somewhere around there.
And its yearly budget?
About $4 billion and then another $3 billion in satellites.
You say in your book, though, that the president almost never talks to the director.
That's right. When I interviewed the director, I asked him how many times in the past year he'd spoken to the president, and he said never.
But that means not just this president, but the previous president.
And he said that's not unusual. The director of CIA, the director of the Central Intelligence Agency, the DCI, speaks to the president every day. But the director of NSA mostly speaks through the National Security Advisor, through the Office of the National Security Advisor, rather than directly to the President.
College Park, Maryland, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Thank you, yes. I suppose now that this act has happened, I guess what I'm concerned about, and I would think most people are concerned about, is how do you prevent a future attack? It seems like this was particularly bold. I go to the Internet and I read papers around different parts of the world. It seems like there's no fear of the U.S. What does the intelligence community know about the pressure points of groups like this? You can't really use nuclear warheads, I suppose, in Afghanistan and Iraq. But what type of things are they afraid of that we could do that would prevent them from making future attacks like this?
Well, I don't know if there's anything that they're afraid of. They seem to be. If you have people who are willing to fly airliners into buildings, they're obviously willing to die and take a lot of people with them. So it doesn't seem to be anything that they're afraid of. The only solution in many cases may be to do what the administration is apparently going to do, which is find them and kill them.
To Cuesta, Florida. Go ahead, please.
Yes. Should I give my views now?
Yes, sir.
I've been an avid listener of C-SPAN for the last 7 years in my retirement in Cuesta, Florida, and hardly have missed the Sunday program, let alone some of the weekly programs. Marvelous. There's 50 channels that I turned to since Tuesday and been watching the television for maybe 50 hours a day. I have never found a diverse view from any of the other channels to get a complete picture of actually what's going on with bin Laden and the Middle East. The only program where I get a conversation of adversaries is your wonderful C-SPAN. My question to you, Mr. bin Laden or Mr. Hussein or Timothy McVeigh, we've convicted and hung whoever the culprit was that did the dastardly attack on our New York City. Can we come to negotiation with any of these people? In Vietnam, the same situation exists when we went in there many, many years ago and we did the five-day bombing on what we call collateral terrorists. I'm originally from St. Louis, and there's a little town between Kansas City and Branson, Missouri, called Knob Noster, Missouri. Several months ago, 30 attacks were carried out from underground at Whiteman Air Force Base to Kosovo, 13 hours one way and 13 hours back. We got Slobodan Milosevic to the World Court. Kristen, Mr. Hitchens says we should take Mr. Kissinger to the World Court. But we will not participate in the World Court if it's any of our people.
All right, so we're going to let you go. Do you either one of you have an opinion on whether or not there's any chance to negotiate with any of these people?
Well, it doesn't look like it. These are people that are willing to die. I think we're well beyond the negotiation stage at this point.
It may be possible to negotiate with Iran or certainly Pakistan in order to get their assistance. It's possibly Iran, and can't be sure about that. But as far as the bin Laden group, I don't think there's any way to negotiate. I mean, when a group wants to live in the 14th century and believes that you should too, and is willing to kill you if you won't, there's nothing to negotiate about.
Go back to an earlier question we had from a caller about coordination. Is there a way to improve the coordination among all these different intelligence gathering organizations?
Well, I think it always can be improved. In the past, there has been a lot of problem in terms of coordination with between NSA and CIA. There were a number of years where the NSA director and the CIA director would actually battle because the CIA wanted more raw data coming from NSA, and the NSA would say, we don't send raw data, which would mean the raw intercepts and all that. We analyze it and then give you the analysis that we produce. So there's competition back and forth about that. But I think a lot of those problems existed during the 70s and 80s to some degree, and they've been worked out now. I don't think that's a huge problem in terms of coordination and cooperation.
Do they ever meet all these groups at one time?
Oh, sure. They have meetings all the time over a lot of different issues. There'll be a meeting on this, and there'll be a representative from each of the agencies discussing what each agency can do. Plus, each agency has people from their agencies and other agencies. So there's a fair amount of cooperation. Back in the days when J. Edgar Hoover ran the FBI and there was a lot of competition between FBI and CIA, and there wasn't a lot of goodwill among the agencies then. But I think now a lot of that is over with.
Honolulu.
There's a National Foreign Intelligence Board, which is the senior forum for the intelligence community, and you have the DCI and the heads of the other agencies meeting to deal with certain issues. And then there's a whole series of committees on specific topics like terrorism or advanced weapon systems, which also consist of lower-level personnel who also meet on a regular basis to try to coordinate efforts and to resolve disputes and disagreements.
Honolulu, go ahead, please.
Good afternoon. My question is to Mr. Bamford. And my question is that, do you think American movies like Air Force One or Under Siege or other hijacking movie that is produced in the U.S. has some negative impact on the American people or society as a whole? And my second question is that, do you think that would teach the terrorists how to penetrate the system?
Thanks.
Well, I think a lot of the movies are pretty far-fetched when it comes to intelligence. The movie that dealt with NSA was Enemy of the State, and while it was very entertaining and I enjoyed it, it didn't really have much to do with reality. They had somebody running down a street with a cell phone saying, turn that satellite over and get a picture inside this hotel room here. It works for a movie maybe, but in reality, it doesn't really work. I think what it does is maybe give the public a false impression that the intelligence community can do things that they really can't do. They'd love to have that ability, but they don't have those abilities. So, as I think I mentioned earlier, the NSA, for example, has been very worried about the treatment that some movies have given it, in that they show the CIA responsible for spies, for assassins and for killing people and so forth. So, movies are always going to stretch the limits of reality, and I think they're entertaining, but I'd take them with a grain of salt.
If you've just joined us, we're talking about two books that we featured on Book Notes tonight, Body of Secrets by James Bamford, and the other one is by Jeffrey Richelson. It's called The Wizards of Langley. We're talking about intelligence, and we continue with Chesterton, Indiana. Hello.
Hello, and good evening, gentlemen. And Mr. Bamford, I read The Puzzle Palace many years ago. My question I direct to both of you. If both of you were appointed director of any of these intelligence agencies tomorrow, and I direct this to both of you, what would your first directive be for the agencies?
Thanks.
Well, if I was appointed director of this, the CIA, under these circumstances, my first directive would be, tell me what went wrong, tell me what you know about what's going on, and tell me how we can know more.
Mr. Bamford.
Well, if I was appointed director of NSA, which is about as unlikely as a possibility there is, I would start looking into the possibility of, as I mentioned before, increasing the analysis capability. It's very difficult these days, but increasing the number of linguists that we're bringing in and trying to concentrate on more analysis and less collection.
Let's go to Wakefield, Rhode Island. Hello.
Brian, I want to thank you for having this forum. It's helping me to calm down a little. Let's see, once I get this straight here. Two men that are on intelligence agencies' watch lists buy tickets in their own name, board a plane, and we see the results. What is the point of having these watch lists if they're not distributed to airlines, to ports? Do they have any purpose to existing at all except to do their own little games?
Well, it's not it was not an intelligence community watch list. It was an INS watch list. But the point, the larger point, is valid. That again, this is one of the things that's going to have to be looked at very carefully. Is what could have been prevented by proper use of this information or expeditious use of this information.
Caller.
I don't want to contradict you, but the New York Times had a story today that two of these men were on the FBI's watch list.
Oh. Caller, as you've been watching this whole week, you say it helped you calm down a little bit. What's been your biggest frustration?
Well, two things. I mean, obviously the horror of all those people dying, but the joke, which is airline security. There were two things that really helped this atrocity. One is the joke that is airline security, and the utter failure of the intelligence community. And that's that you're helping with this partially, because you're making it clear that there's. They couldn't have done quite as much as I'm thinking, but it's still, these two men were on the FBI watch list, and I'd like to know how they got on an airplane.
Jim Bamford.
Well, I think those are some of the questions that are going to be asked very aggressively this week of the intelligence agencies if the Congress holds hearings and behind closed doors at the intelligence agencies. There are certain restrictions, as I mentioned before, on some agencies. The CIA, for example, can't work in the United States at all. And NSA is restricted in terms of who it can eavesdrop on in the United States. So the FBI is the agency that has the primary responsibility in terms of keeping track of people who are suspected of terrorist activities or whatever.
Playa del Rey, California. Hello.
Hello. I had two questions. One, I'm completely impressed with the work of both gentlemen in this area and knowledge of our intelligence. On one side of it, is it possible we could be, by providing this information, we could be providing something to the other side or to the other sides about what we know, and certain spy satellites can pick up certain kinds of phone calls? And are we giving away anything here by this kind of television dialogue? The other question is, I do work in public health, and we have all become much more progressively aware about the potentials for bioterrorism. And has there been anything picked up in any of the intelligence communities for those kinds of plans? Thank you.
Giving anything away?
No. There's certain facts, basic facts, that stem from the laws of physics and from reporting for many years that's well known. You can fly a satellite in a low Earth orbit, and you can take a photograph if there's something there to photograph. Anybody who puts any communications in the air, whether it's by cell phone, radio, telephone, any other means, that can possibly be intercepted if it's targeted. So talking about the fact that we have satellites and they can intercept all these communications or photograph large areas of the world is nothing new. When there can be a compromise is if somebody says, we intercepted this particular conversation yesterday. Then that tells the person that he was being eavesdropped on. In some cases, he may not care, but in other cases, he may care very much and then take countermeasures.
What about the question was about this forum being helpful to a foreign government, but what about the books? Do you know of foreign governments that have bought your books?
Well, I don't know specifically, but I would assume so. But in my book, for example, I don't get into the technology very much. I talk mostly about the history, how the agency was formed, what it does, and how it works. And 90% of the information comes from documents that the agency has released or have gotten from the archives or have gotten somewhere from the government itself. And the other percentage of information comes from interviewing the former officials who currently work there or formerly work there. So, you know, they're in a better position than I to decide what is releasable and what isn't.
His second question is about bioterrorism.
I don't know of anything that's been picked up. Certainly it's a high intelligence priority, and some people have said one of the problems is that along with chemical and nuclear has been such a focus in the last few years that we've ignored this type of the thing that happened on Tuesday.
New York City, you're next. Go ahead, please.
Hello, thank you for taking the call. Either one of the gentlemen, is there any history of these agencies working with private industry to offset some of the human resource tasks? And do you see any collaboration in the future with any private industry? And as one example, I would say perhaps some of these security companies, Kroll International comes to mind, but those kinds of companies or any other companies to help out with the human resources side, specifically on the analysis side. Thank you.
Jim Bamford.
Well, actually, that's one of the things that the NSA in particular is moving greatly towards, is to what's known as outsourcing. In other words, getting outside corporations to come in and do a lot of the work. They think it's financially beneficial to do it that way, and it's very controversial to bring all these outside companies in to this extremely secret agency and have them do a lot of functions. Mostly what they've been having these companies do is work on personnel issues and non-critical intelligence collection activities and leaving the intelligence collection to the full-time employees.
When you talk about outside contracts, there's just one interesting statistic that you had on page 522. In just one year, 1998, and in Maryland alone, NSA awarded more than 13,000 contracts worth more than $700 million.
That's right. NSA contracts out for a lot of information in terms of building their crypto systems and actually operating some of the or actually building some of the eavesdropping systems, the signals intelligence systems. Most of that is done by private corporations. The actual analysis, however, has never been contracted out, and that's left almost exclusively with NSA employees. However, one other area, in terms of listening posts, where they run these listening posts around the world to intercept the communications, those are and have been for a number of years contracted out to a variety of contractors. So it's a mix of private industry and government agency, and it's becoming more and more of a involvement from the outside.
If you've just joined us, it's an unusual departure for us at Book Notes. This is the first live Book Notes we've ever had in 13 years. First time we've ever had two guests on that have written two different books, and the subject is intelligence. And we've got about 25 minutes to go before we end our special two-hour show. We go to San Diego next. You're on the air.
Good evening, gentlemen. Hi, Jim. This is J.W. out in San Diego.
Oh, good seeing you. Good hearing from you, J.W.
How you doing? I'm really enjoying this. I appreciate the breadth and the width of your knowledge of these agencies. But I got a question for you I'd like to test, Jim. What will happen because of this with the relative power of the three agencies? Who will gain, who will lose, who will remain the same, and why? Thanks.
That's a good question.
What three agencies are you talking about?
Well, I assume he's talking about the NSA, the CIA, and maybe the DIA or NRO, one of the other agencies. The NSA has been gaining in power over the years, primarily because it collects a vast majority of the intelligence out there, and because it's so large and so powerful in a lot of ways. The CIA started out with a lot of the intelligence collection capabilities, such as satellite intelligence collection and so forth, and that went to other agencies. So there has been sort of behind the scenes some power struggles between the NSA and CIA. I know there was a lot of conflicts between Admiral Inman and the director of the CIA, Stansfield Turner, at the time. A lot of power conflicts between the two. Also, most people don't realize it's the Department of Defense. It's actually the Secretary of Defense who runs most of the intelligence in the country, almost all of it. The CIA runs a very small portion of it, just the human agents that are sent overseas. So there's a power battle between the CIA and the Department of Defense that goes on all the time also.
You told us that the National Security Agency is about halfway between Washington and Baltimore.
Yes.
And the CIA is out in Langley, Virginia, out in McLean.
Right.
Where is the Defense Intelligence Agency?
Well, that's over at Bowling Air Force Base across on the other side of the Anacostia River from Washington.
None of these outfits are close. FBI is downtown.
Well, the other agencies, the National Reconnaissance Office is also out near Dulles Airport. So they're sort of scattered around, which is probably sensible if you're worried about terrorist incidents, that they're not all in one location.
Chevy Chase, Maryland, you're on the air. Go ahead, please.
Hi, I want to thank you for C-SPAN. It's a fabulous show. I do have some questions, though. Can you tell me, do you think that the conservatives are using this event to get what they've always wanted, which is domestic surveillance? And did George Sr. Lie before Congress when he was the CIA director regarding domestic intelligence gathering and infiltration of student groups?
Jeffrey Richardson.
As far as the second, I have no idea. As far as the first, domestic surveillance, I think what you're going to see partially in response to this is people's preconceived notions about what was wrong, being taking this event as proof that their preconceived notions were right about what gaps or vulnerabilities existed. So that people who have been saying that we don't have enough of a human capability, that we're not penetrating these groups, are going to take this event as proof that it's true. People who want to spend more money on certain things are going to take this as proof that they should spend more money, and those who wanted tighter domestic surveillance are going to conclude that, or previously are going to conclude that this incident is proof that there needs to be more of that surveillance. And in some cases they may be right, in some cases they may be wrong, and in a lot of cases it won't be because of the facts, it'll be because of what they already believe in.
How long have you been in Washington?
Since 1982.
And have you done any work for committees or for administrations?
No.
And the National Security Archive is how large?
It consists of about, I guess, 30 people.
And how long have you been with them?
Since 1987.
Who underwrites that organization?
It's a combination of grants from usual foundations over the years. I think Ford and W. Walton Jones and several others. And then it also makes money from the document sets it sells to the university libraries.
And James Bamford, have you ever worked for politicians or committees?
No, I've testified before Congress, but I've never worked for Congress.
You wanted to say something?
Well, I was going to mention, I agree that I think some of these groups will use this incident as an excuse for pushing for more restricted or more use domestically of law enforcement and intelligence agencies. I think the there had been a fairly nice balance before in terms of the balance of civil liberties and the needs of the intelligence community. I think this may push it in away from civil liberties more towards domestic use of intelligence agencies. For example, there's now a growing effort to restrict American use of encryption, for example, and increase the use of eavesdropping and wiretapping across the country. So I think there will be moves in those directions in the next weeks and months.
Colorado Springs, you're on the air.
Hi, thank you for C-SPAN. Yes, Mr. Bamford, I've read your book. And
thank
I
you.
Was wondering, one thing that kind of troubled me was some of the things you said about Israel. In light of the reports coming out from the London Telegraph and Fox News about how the Mossad tried to warn our intelligence agencies about several of these gentlemen, do you still stick by the statement that Israel is not a very productive source of intelligence? Thank you very much. Bye.
Well, that's what I've heard from other people in the intelligence community, that they don't get an awful lot of intelligence out of Israel that's tremendously useful.
They don't give it to us, or they don't produce it.
Well, it could be one of either or both. I mean, we get intelligence on some of the Middle East countries, but again, this was coming from people both at NSA and also at several of the defense intelligence agencies.
You mentioned earlier Christopher Cox, congressman, is big name in active on the Hill in intelligence.
Well, he was in charge of the report on the dealing with the People's Republic of China and nuclear secrets.
The reason I bring it up is who else in this town is, do you think, has strong views on intelligence and is active and is visible, and you would suspect in the next couple months would be involved in some kind of a look at intelligence, a relook at them?
Well,
elected officials.
Elected officials, I think the chairman of the committees are the people who are going to do the primary looking. Senators Graham and Shelby on the Senate side, Porter Goss on the House side. I think you have also outside people. Admiral David Jeremiah has chaired several outside reviews of various aspects of the intelligence community, and it wouldn't surprise me if he winds up doing another one.
What about the President's Foreign Intelligence Board? What does that do? Does it have any power? Has it had any influence?
Well, it has a fair amount of influence. It was set up back in the Eisenhower administration, and it's supposed to be a group of outside consultants, people who have been in the government previously, and some people have never had any government experience. At one point, they were sort of the best and brightest on the outside. There were Edwin Land, who developed a lot of the camera lenses for spy satellites, and other people who knew a lot about technology. And it's changed over the years. But currently, the group is used largely to take a look at big issues and advise the president on how he should deal with these issues. So the Chinese espionage, for example, is one issue they looked at a few years ago.
How many?
It's very small. It's I don't know the exact number right now. Maybe a dozen, or give or take five or six.
Has this president assigned somebody to that job as chairman?
You know, I haven't found out whether he's appointed new people to the job or not. Virtually every president appoints various people. Some presidents have appointed sort of cronies in the past. Others have used it to appoint brilliant people in the scientific community. So it's very different. And I'm not sure what President Bush has done.
Do you know?
No, I don't know who's chairman.
Princeton, New Jersey. Go ahead, please.
Good evening. It's often been said that the military leaders of any army are always superbly prepared to fight the last war. And I wonder if it's a similar problem here with these intelligence agencies, that they are essentially reactive and not proactive. And when faced with a very intelligent and creative terrorist organization, they will be behind the curve constantly.
Well, that's certainly a problem, or that they are in some ways ahead of the curve, in that maybe the next attack will be, you know, hopefully there won't be one, but maybe there will be a chemical or biological or nuclear attack which they had been expecting or feared now, and instead of the attack that we had Tuesday. So really what they have to do is look at what all the possibilities are and not just focus on one particular possibility or set of possibilities.
Sonoma, California, go ahead, please.
I have one question for each of the gentlemen. I've read Mr. Bamford's book, both of them, and my question on the most recent one was, he made a very provocative comment in there, if I understood correctly, and that was, this is in regard to the Liberty incident, and that was that the, first of all, that the Israelis started the 67 war, if I understood it correctly, and also that the Liberty was attacked as a consequence of the information that we had, and there were some other things that he made. My question to Mr. Richelson is with regard to the withdrawal of the SR-71, the successor to the A-12 spy plane, and its impact on overhead reconnaissance, and particularly in a timely fashion.
Thanks, caller.
Yeah, in regard to those two questions, I don't think there's any question that Israel moved into Egypt before Egypt moved into Israel in the 67 war. I mean, that's part of history now. The other question had to do with the USS Liberty. The Liberty was a NSA spy ship that was sailing off the Sinai coast during the 1967 war in broad daylight around 2 in the afternoon during the war. The ship was attacked for more than an hour by Israeli aircraft and Israeli torpedo boats. More than five torpedoes were shot at the ship, and the ship was extensively damaged by rocket fire, cannon fire, and napalm. 34 Americans were killed, 171 were wounded. All the evidence points out that there's no reason that the Israelis should have mistaken that ship for anything other than what it was. An American ship flying an American flag with a U.S. With its U.S. name on the back, and in the reports that I've seen from NSA, there were a great deal of NSA people who thought that the attack may have been deliberate, and that includes the director of NSA at the time, the deputy director, the deputy chief of operations, the secretary of state, at the time, the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Tom Moore, at the time. So there's a lot of evidence. It's a very controversial topic, and my argument has always been that there should have been a more intensive investigation, and there's still time to do an intensive investigation.
He asked about the SR-71. What plane is this?
That's the A-12 Oxcart, which is a single-seat plane, and the SR-71 was a two-seat version of that. And the Oxcart only operated really from 1967 to 1968, when the CIA lost the bureaucratic battle with the Air Force, and the SR-71s replaced the A-12s, but they look very much the same. As far as the question of their replacement, they were definitely replaced prior to their having to be retired. Eventually, the engines would have given out, and there weren't really good replacements, from what I understand. But certainly, they were retired prematurely because the Air Force basically didn't want to pay for a national intelligence system instead of they rather pay for fighter wings. And the result was that we did lose some flexibility, because a plane like that can go from point A to B in a very fast amount of time and cover all the territory in between with its rather impressive photographic capabilities. Whereas the limitation of a satellite is that it's orbiting the Earth as the Earth is revolving around its axis. So to go from, say, one point in Syria to another point in Syria would take you several passes of the satellite, whereas the plane could do it in one mission.
Omaha, Nebraska, you're next.
Yeah, my question is, what sort of oversight or audit function is there on these agencies? And I'm thinking about the whole gamut, financial, compliance with the law, and performance, and how can it be improved, or does it need to be improved, given the obvious restrictions because of the need for secrecy?
James Bamford.
Well, the primary oversight body is the House and Senate Intelligence Committees. You have a oversight capability to some degree in this PIFIAB, the President's Foreign Intelligence Advisory Board, but the main oversight is from the House and Senate. The problem is that you have very, very large agencies doing very, very secret work and very complex work, as both Jeff and I write about in our books, very highly technical work. You have a very small committee in Congress. So the actual congressmen and senators themselves have many responsibilities, many committees they're on, not just the Intelligence Committee. And the staff is very small compared to the large agency. So you get to the point where it's a legitimate question as to whether they can adequately oversee this enormous intelligence community of 100,000 people or more, with a staff of, less than 200 maybe.
You both said earlier that there are about 100,000 people in this government dealing with intelligence. How well educated are those 100,000?
Well, some of them are very well educated. Certainly, if you're going to do work on designing technical collection systems, you have to have advanced degrees in engineering and physics. And if you simply look at the sort of ads for certain positions in the CIA or NRO and what it takes, you have to...
NRO stands for?
National Reconnaissance Office. You have to be an engineer or a physicist or a computer scientist. So you have very many people who are very highly educated.
People want to go to work for these organizations today?
Sure, yeah. They've got a lot of people that are applying for them. The problem they have, especially at NSA, is that they want the same type of people that a lot of companies and private industry want. They want electrical engineers, computer scientists, and mathematicians to some degree. And those people are very highly desired by private industry, who can offer more money. So you've got a problem of competing with private industry for these people who know how to design these huge satellites to listen in and these big machines to break codes.
Do they have people volunteering, or are they interested in human intelligence gathering out there in the field, trying to break through around the world? I mean, is there much interest in that?
Do you mean people coming to the CIA wanting to sponsor?
Working for one of our intelligence agencies and do the field work out there around the world.
Well, sure. There are people who sign up for the Directorate of Operations, and they are the people who go through training at Camp Perry in Virginia and learn all these sort of skills, the covert skills that they need, and then they're deployed out into the field either under diplomatic cover or in some cases as businessmen, apparently businessmen, who then go up about the business of spying when they're not doing their cover work.
Again, the number of people you think are in human intelligence?
Out in the field, a few thousand.
One of the things that Director Tenet has done, I think, in this fairly recently was in the last few years, the new recruits that he gets into the clandestine service, which are the people that are actually going out into the field, In addition to their training down at the, as Jeff said, Camp Perry, otherwise known as the Farm, which is their training ground, they have to jump out of a plane five times, do parachute jumps five times. So I think they're trying to get them motivated into doing clandestine work.
Cedar Fort, Utah, you're on the air.
Yes, thanks for C-SPAN, first of all. And you know, the thing that is most devastating about this to me is the fact that we were so defenseless. We talk about intelligence and security. What happened to defense? We've allowed the Sarah Brady's of the world to disarm the honest citizens of the U.S. And you look at this damage that's been done, these buildings taken down and thousands of people killed, and realize it was done with box knives. What is wrong with this picture, folks?
Comment from either one of you?
Well, I think the leverage that hijackers have has pretty much been lost in the future, because I think in these incidents, probably all the people originally thought that this was going to be the standard type of hijacking, where they go land someplace and it's an ordeal, but the odds are that everybody's going to survive. Next time around, if anybody tries it, I mean, I would just expect that everybody's going to jump them, because when you essentially believe that you're going to die in 25 minutes if you don't do something, then the hijackers have no leverage.
Well, in addition to the box cutters, I think they also brought out these boxes that they said were bombs and they were going to blow up the plane. I mean, obviously they weren't, but that was one other device they used to try to intimidate the passengers and maybe the crew.
How often in history have we had to deal with people who are willing to commit suicide to get what they want?
Well,
has anything quite like this ever happened, where you have 19 people that knew they were going to die?
Well, kamikaze pilots in World War II, but never that I can think of do we have this many people willing to commit suicide against these type of targets.
Buckhannon, West Virginia, you're on the air.
Thank you for taking my call. I would like to know, don't you think that there's been a huge diminishing of our ability ever since the U-2 was shot down? And could not this all have been the beginning of what's happening now?
Thanks. What year was it the U-2 was shot down?
The U-2 was shot down in 1960, and it was replaced within a month by the Corona spy satellite, which took more photos in one day than the U-2 took in 4 years of operations. And we still have U-2s flying around the world. So we certainly haven't lost anything in capability. It's grown immensely. It's just that the target is very different than the target for which either the U-2 or the spy satellites were originally designed for.
Twin Forks, Colorado. Go ahead, please.
Yes. Mr. Bamford.
Yes.
Looking on your book on page 283. Saigon, 68. I used to go there to make a lot of phone calls home. Two questions. Number one, I'm struggling for the remembrance of that facility right outside of Tonsonet.
The facility, the NSA facility? I can't remember it right now myself either. It's the tip of my tongue. I just can't think of it.
Caller, what point do you want to make?
No, I just used to drive my troops down there sometimes on Sunday mornings and have everyone call home, and it was signals people were great, and we just enjoyed the opportunity to communicate back with the States.
Thanks, caller. Let's go over our last call of this program to Fort Jackson, South Carolina. Hello, you're on the air.
Thank you, gentlemen, for taking my call. My question quickly is, of the published intelligence reform proposals during the 1990s, not including budget-saving techniques, what specific areas much the intelligence community now focus on to prepare for the 21st century?
Thanks.
I think they've got to concentrate on two things. One is, as we've talked about many times in the past, increasing human capability to penetrate these new terrorist organizations. And the second thing is to increase the ability to analyze the tremendous amount of information they've been able to collect in order to get a warning much quicker. It doesn't make much sense to be able to pick up all this information, and some of which may give you a warning of an attack, but not be able to read it until a week after the attack. So I think those are two of the critical areas.
What was your reaction from the CIA when your book came out?
I haven't really had any yet. I know that some people who I interviewed and were with the agency have read it and liked it, but I haven't heard anything officially or even from any people still in the CIA.
We're out of time, and we have two books to show you. This one is called The Wizards of Langley. Jeffrey T. Richelson is the author of that. Book has been out just about a month, and this book has been out for the last several months by James Bamford called Body of Secrets. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us on Book Notes, this special program.
Thanks, Brian.
For a transcript of this book notes, call 1-800-777-TEXT. For a video copy, call 1-877-ON-C-SPAN. To learn more about book notes, visit us on the World Wide Web at booknotes.org. Next week on Book Notes, our